Hi everyone, this is Octavia Kozak. The following is my interview with Isaac Marion, who wrote the novel Warm Bodies, which was adapted into a movie coming out in February, starring Nicholas Hoult and John Malkovich. And I have a recording add-on on Skype, and I didn't realize that it was also recording me as well, so that's why I look really schlubby and kind of unflattering, so just wanted to give you a heads up on that. I'm gonna show you a trailer first for those of you not familiar with the film, and then we'll get along with the interview. Thank you.
Corpses do not think. They do not bleed. They are incapable of remorse.
Nice watch. I don't want to be this way. I'm lonely. I'm lost. Wait, I'm literally lost. I've never been in this part of the airport before. I want to spend my life with a girl like you. Say something human. Nailed it.
Dad, he saved my life. I don't understand, but he's changing and he's learning to be human again.
Don't be creepy, don't be creepy. Oh, man.
We are their food source. They are not becoming vegan.
Keep you safe.
Warm bodies.
Be dead. It's too much.
Rated PG-13, February 1st.
Whenever you're ready.
I'm ready.
Okay, so first of all, did you see the film?
Yeah, I did.
And what's your capsule review of it?
I really like it. It's fun. It's charming, really unusual film. I think it's original. It's has a fresh style to it. I think it's great.
Cool. And, can you kind of take us through the process of how the book ended up getting optioned for the film adaptation? Was it, the process of getting it optioned and the adaptation and having it greenlit? Was this whole thing, did that happen pretty smoothly, or was it challenging?
It happened, I mean, it was all new to me, so I don't really know what is considered smooth or not, but from what people told me, it was kind of impossibly smooth how quickly and efficiently everything happened. It just went directly from being optioned by the producer to being optioned by the studio to suddenly there's a director, there's a script, they're shooting, and it was like there was really no stalls at any point of the process. So from what I told, that's pretty unusual. Usually they bat it around for a while and struggle with it. So yeah, it was like a really efficient organic process from what I understand.
And how much were you personally involved in adapting the novel? The adaptation process. Did you just kind of sign off the rights, and a couple of years later you just get the screener in the mail, or were you more personally involved with the screenwriting?
I didn't do any of the writing myself. It wasn't like a collaboration, but they consulted me a lot. Like it was, they at various stages, and when they were casting, they would say, here's some people we're thinking about, and here's what do you think of this director, and then once the director was on board, he came out and had lunch with me and like talked about his vision for the whole thing, like what he was going for, and then at various stages it just kind of continued. Like as he was writing the script, he would call me and ask me questions about it, like how we'd have meetings about ideas, like how to visualize things, and then when he had scripts written, I got to read them and give notes on them, and some of them were actually done in the movie. So it felt to me like they actually cared what I thought, and it wasn't like I was dictating what they do. In the end, it's still their movie and their own spin on it, which is always going to be different, especially with a really hard to film book like this. So but I felt like they actually cared, and they didn't really have to care, because at the time, no one had any idea this book existed. It hadn't even been published yet when they first came on board. So yeah, they could have just completely mangled it and done their own thing, but they didn't.
So it was It was optioned first, and then Jonathan Levine kind of came on board after that.
Yeah, it was optioned and sold to publishers kind of almost simultaneously. That it was sort of circulating in industry circles, and it kind of went in those two different directions at the same time. And so by the time the publisher was on board, it was already in the works with the movie. But yeah, I think Jonathan came on board, you know, somewhere in the middle there. They'd been discussing it for a while and talking to various directors, and before they settled on a choice. So yeah, and that's where it really got started, is once he was on board, because he was also the writer.
Yeah. So he was he kind of sought out to adapt it first, or to adapt it and direct it at the same time? And what did you and it sounds like you were happy with him as a choice.
Yeah, I was a fan of his already before any of this even started happening, because I'd seen his well, not technically his first, but his first released movie is The Whackness, and I really liked that movie, and I knew also that he had written the script for that. And I knew they were from the beginning, they were saying they were looking for a writer-director, like someone who would have kind of a unique auteur kind of style, where it's not like it's being workshopped to five different screenwriters and everybody pitches in a chunk, which is usually the process with Hollywood movies. So it was great that they were taking that approach. And then when they talked to him, I was like, oh, I love that movie. And he wrote that, and it has a great script. So I was really excited when he came on board.
Cool. And it was interesting when you said it's a hard book to adapt, because I read the book after watching the movie, and it has a really fast pace, and it's very visual, and I do a lot of screenplay coverage as well, so reading it almost felt like it was like reading a longer screenplay written in prose. And was it, while you were writing the book, was it your intention to see the story in film form, or was it a surprise to you when it was optioned for a film adaptation?
It was a complete surprise. I mean, I had no expectations that that would happen. I just wanted to get a book published, and that was always my primary concern. And when that stuff started happening at the same time, you know, it was exciting and amazing, but I definitely didn't write it ever assuming that would happen, and most definitely didn't write it as a treatment or anything. What I mean by hard to film is not so much, I mean, I do tend to write in kind of a cinematic style, a visual style, but more in terms of just the awkward juxtaposition of tone, where you've got like bizarre premise and sort of these comedy satirical elements, and then suddenly you're supposed to invest emotion, and like it's not really a comedy, it's not a romance, it's not really a drama, it's just kind of, it goes whiplashing back and forth a lot. So that was hard to pull off, even in the book, where I have all the time that I want to carefully make the prose transition into the next tone, but to do it in a film, it's much trickier.
Yeah, I think he managed to do it really well. It looked like it wasn't, the clever aspect of it was, I thought it wasn't a zombie film trying to kind of inject it with romantic comedy elements. It was kind of like a romance with zombie elements, and I think he did a really good job with that. And so what are your top three zombie films, as well as your top three romantic comedies?
I'd have to say the top three zombie films would be probably 28 Days Later, Shaun of the Dead, and I don't know, for a third, I might just have to say Night of the Living Dead as the originator. I really like those first two because, for very opposite reasons, like 28 Days Later is kind of gives the genre some class, some art house feel, takes itself seriously. It's not intended to be campy. Whereas Shaun of the Dead is really funny and it's fun with all the genre stuff. So I like the combination of those two is sort of what I was trying to do. As far as romantic comedies, I'm not really sure what things would be classed as that. I mean, I know some ones are really obvious, like the, you know, Meg Ryan, Tom Hanks kind of. But
you can even go as far as films like maybe The Apartment with Jack Lemmon or Roman Holiday. You know, you go to some of the older films like that. But basically, romance stories, or I could just rephrase the question as like, what are your top three romance films or stories?
Probably Eternal Sunshine would definitely be. Definitely in the top three. That it may be in my top three films of any genre. Maybe Before Sunrise, like a romance. I really like that movie.
Yeah, they have a new one coming out too. They make a new one every 9 years or so. So that's exciting.
Yeah.
I really like Before Sunset too.
Yeah, they're both good. I particularly like the first one, but yeah, I don't, maybe Breakfast at Tiffany's or something. I don't know. It's a solid, that's probably solidly a romantic comedy.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it is actually. But, do you, so you like Night of the Living Dead more than Dawn of the Dead?
It's tough to say. I mean, that whole series, at least the 60s and 70s version of it seems pretty comparable to me. Like they all have kind of a similar feel. Dawn of the Dead, that's the one with the mall, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's at the Monroeville Mall.
I don't know. I guess I haven't put a lot of thought into comparing them. I enjoy them all for different reasons.
The zombies, actually, I don't know if that was on purpose by Jonathan Levine, but the zombie makeup in Warm Bodies reminded me a lot of the makeup in Dawn of the Dead.
Yeah.
And especially the idea that the zombies, even when they're when they're dead, they still have some remnants of their past lives, so they keep still doing the same routines that they did when they were alive, and that's why they're kind of crowding the malls, because that used to be something that, you know, so that same kind of idea I thought was kind of taken to a new level in Warm Bodies.
Look, that's even more pronounced, where they all kind of have these mindless repetitions of various human rituals. Like they have church services and they get married, but none of it, they don't know why they're doing it or what it means. They just kind of go through these echoes of what they used to do. And it definitely captured some of that in the movie.
Yeah, and I'm guessing you're aware of the some of the media trying to generate buzz on the film by kind of calling it like a zombie version of Twilight. And how much does that piss you off on a scale of 1 to 10?
I think it depends on how they're saying it. I mean, I just think it's a really lazy comparison. I think it's they obviously haven't seen the movie, much less read the book, if they're saying that, because neither of the things in reality, it's only on the very superficial level where you just hear the premise that you would think that it sounds like that. But the execution, the tone, the style, the content, the themes is all completely different. So it pisses me off in the sense that, just like, come on, media, like, try a little harder. Like, actually pay attention to the stuff you're talking about. It's your job. So I think it died down a lot, those comparisons, once the trailer actually came out, because people, and they're like, oh, that really has a whole different style and is way different. And before that, it was harder to convince people of that, because they didn't really have anything to go on but the premise. They just heard like, oh, undead boy and meets girl, it's Twilight. So that was a frustrating time, because I'm gonna like get pissed off and defensive about it, but I was like, please, trailer, come out and from these comparisons.
I had the same reaction to it when I first read about it, and there was all that Twilight comparisons going on. And then, when I saw the trailer, my hopes were up. And then when I saw the movie, I realized that this is completely different. And then when you read the book, book is, of course, so much more adult and, has a lot more of like a kind of an adult horror romance feel to it, that it's, it's just like that comparison is completely baseless, but I just wanted to find out what you feel about that.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's supposed to be an adult novel. I don't really know. Well, I know where the young adult thing came from. It's because there's just so many associations with young adult authors and movies that it just kind of people shoved it into that category without reading it or really even thinking it through. But that was never my intention to write a YA book. It just kind of got lumped in with that. But the fun thing about that is that people go into it expecting that, and then they're suddenly surprised, like, whoa, I wasn't expecting all this. And it's kind of fun to have my little told you so moments with that.
Yeah, I was definitely surprised by how good it was, both the movie and the book.
That's phenomenal. I thought it was going to be terrible and pleasantly surprised. So
yeah,
every review starts out that way.
Yeah, it turned out really, really good. And so you self-published three novels before having Warm Bodies published. What would you say to aspiring writers who might be having trouble getting their first novel published and maybe are considering throwing in the towel?
It's always hard for me to give advice on that because the way it happened for me was so unusual. It's not really reproducible. I can't just say, well, do what I did, just get randomly discovered because it's that simple. But I think, and with my experience, the only things that are universal enough to suggest to people would just be to don't sit there obsessing about, like, I've had people email me like, I want to be a writer too, and I just can't wait to have a book turn into a movie. And I'm like, whoa, you're getting way ahead of yourself. Like, just first of all, finish a book. That's step one. You're not gonna, no one's gonna want to see like your idea for a novel. Like, so many people tell me they want to write a novel, but I've only talked to maybe two or three that have actually written one. So that's obviously the most important thing, is to actually create something that people can see. And then just putting it out there as much as possible. In my case, I put my short stories on my website and just kind of had them available to anyone to come across, and ended up being someone who actually was in a position to push me onto people's desks, stumbled across it. But if not that, even if that doesn't happen, there's still the benefit of having a reward at the end of the process. Like, if you're spending 2 years of your life writing a book, and then you have to think, well, no one's ever going to get to read this until it's published 2 years later, it's pretty discouraging. So that's why I self-published those in small quantities, kind of a temporary thing, just so I'd have some physical copies to show people, who get keeping me motivated to actually finish it.
Yeah, that really does make a difference when you see your work in printed form. I've been an online film critic for so long, and I just started writing for a magazine like about a year ago, and it really does make a difference when you see it in physical form and you get to touch it, and it's like right there. So how was your so when you were kind of posting your short stories online, is that how kind of you got publisher contacted you and asked you to write this novel, or how did you come about writing and getting Warm Bodies published?
It was kind of a convoluted process, which is it's tough to lay it out concisely, but basically somebody found the original short story that I based this novel on, sort of a talent scout person. She was trying to find people who had potential and get them in the right place that they need to be seen and exposed. And she set me up with this freelance editor who ended up working with me on editing what the novel that I ended up writing. Then when that was done, she really liked the book and asked if she could like send it out to some of her contacts. And she sort of worked in and out of the film industry. So she sort of put it into circulation within just the entertainment and industry in general. Yeah. It went to this producer and also literary agent at pretty much simultaneously. They got a hold of it. They both were interested. And so it kind of happened at the same time. Like, while the literary agent was shopping it around to get a book deal, the producer was shopping it around to make a film happen. And so it kind of coincided in a really unusual way.
And that's great. So it was optioned for a film before it was published?
Yeah, slightly. Yeah.
Wow. Oh, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah,